How are you? Okay, welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for another STROLO University class. Today we are doing positivity and awareness. And I would just like to welcome you all. As you know, that STROLO U was created at the start of the COVID pandemic as a way to both physical and to offer physical and mental activities and classes to help benefit the cystic fibrosis community through the difficult months while society isolated at home. The CFLF expanded this program with a new spring and fall semester, adding brand new classes and incorporating more educational and informative classes to the mix. The CFLF would like to thank all the individual supporters and the STROLO U instructors for their participation in making STROLO University a positive resource and experience for people with CF. We hope that you enjoy today's class, and please, you know, check in for more wonderful classes at cflf.org/strolo-u. We have a whole bunch of like great classes and different activities. So feel free to look at them. And we also have what we are calling Watch to Win. So with that, for after each class, we are going to give you guys a letter. And at the end of the week, those letters are going to spell out a word, and you email us the word and receive a great prize. So one more thing, just wanted to say a quick shout out to our wonderful sponsors, Chiesi, Viatris, Nestle Health Science, Translate Bio, and Kruger Health. Thank you for your support. We appreciate you. Without you, it would be really hard to get this going. So now I would like to hand the mic over to Meagan Hall, who is going to bring us some positivity and wins. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Hopefully, let's see. Am I sharing? Let's see. Okay. Sorry. Technological difficulties. Okay. There we go. Can you see my screen with my name and whatnot? Okay. Awesome. Thank you so much for having me. This is the third class I've taught this spring, and I did a bunch of classes last spring too. And I did mostly hip hop dance last spring, and but this spring I'm doing a couple of these self-compassion classes, as well as I did a hip hop class a couple weeks ago. So as this first slide shows, I am a social worker. I am the social worker at our pediatric, CF clinic. I up here in Portland, Maine. I also was our mental health coordinator for both our pediatric and adult clinics. But I am back to focusing mostly on our pediatric clinics, and just really excited to be here and really just love my work with the CF community. And I've been in my role for about 8 years, and I was telling Tiffany, and I think Giorgio, I have my Great Stride shirt on because we have our virtual walk this weekend. So, and it's exciting that it's CF month, CF awareness month, which is why I have a little purple in my hair too. So, and I know I did a similar class like a month or so ago, but what I'm going to try to do is, incorporate some different things I didn't really get to. And also, obviously, if anybody has questions, I'm by no means an expert, nor need to lecture. So if anybody has questions, feel free to jump in. So, let's see. Yeah. Okay. So the first thing, just to kind of what we're going to do tonight, we're going to talk about what is self-compassion and self-care. Self-care is a word that's been around for a while, right? It's kind of buzzy. And then we're going to talk about some tips for decompression. Hi, Brian. And kind of some ways to achieve some decompression, self-compassion, those sorts of things. So and then at the very end, we'll revisit. We did an exercise a month or so ago, and we'll do something similar, but I wanted to put a bunch of content first. And again, if you have any questions, feel free to pop into the chat or wherever. So I love the word self-compassion, because self-compassion to me encompasses more than self-care. Again, self-care is so buzzy, right? Like, I mean, Gwyneth Paltrow like does self-care, and it's kind of silly. I'm sorry if Gwyneth Paltrow is on Facebook listening to this, but you know, it's, you know, self-care can be super buzzy. It can just be this thing that, yes, it's important, but I think self-compassion really encompasses more than that. And it really, you know, as the screen shows, encompasses recognizing when we're stressed, being mindful of that. And not only recognizing it, but not being judgmental or being, you know, overreading it, right? Just kind of saying like, I am stressed and that happens. What can I do to feel better versus I'm stressed. Now I'm stressed out about being stressed. And self-kindness. So being supportive and understanding. I always say to my patients and often to myself and my friends, like, you know, you got to be kind to yourself, right? We're so good at being kind to others, but that idea of being kind to oneself and being gracious towards oneself. I have this amazing yoga teacher I go to, and one of the quotes that she often says is, and I have no idea who this quote is by, but if I asked you to list all the things that you loved, how long would it take for you to put yourself down? Like, where would you be? Would you even think to put yourself down? Or would you think to put all kinds of other things? So, you know, self-kindness, right? Just being really kind towards ourselves and not being overly critical. And then connectedness, which is, you know, so nice that we have these classes to join together. I think the whole Zoom land has been a blessing and a curse. It's connected so many people, but you know, it's also nicer, right, when we can be connected more in person. So we are not alone. And I think this year is definitely kind of stressed that, that we're all kind of making mistakes and experiencing difficulties. And if this past year hasn't been a time of connectedness around difficulties, I can't think of many other examples, unfortunately, that have really kind of said, you know what, we're all experiencing a lot of stress in COVID stress. So self-compassion. I really love the term self-compassion. Self-care is something that we think of as more activities focused, you know, stay fit and healthy, you know, things that aren't probably that uncommon that you hear, or the sleep routine, having a you know, a healthy diet for you, whatever that means. If you're at a work environment, taking lunch breaks. If you work from home, taking lunch breaks. If it's a Saturday, make sure you're taking a lunch break, making sure that you're just taking some time during the day. I was saying earlier as we were getting on, I'm up in Maine and it's spring. I know it's probably like been spring other places for a while, but it's so nice that it's actually like, oh, you can actually go outside and have some sunshine and get some fresh air and not get snowed on or frozen. I hope people have pets that they can take for walks and whatnot. And then, you know, if you do have earned time or time off and you need a day off, making sure that you're taking that time off. So self-care is part of self-compassion, but it's not the end all be all. And these are kind of my disclaimers that I always say when I'm doing this training with staff, is that, you know, self-care is self-interest. If you're a giving person, if you're used to caring for others, if you're used to putting others before you, it can really feel like it's a selfish thing to take time for yourself. But it's money in the bank, right? It gives us money in the bank to keep doing the things just that we want to do and keep being there for other people. And so the good old airplane analogy, right? They say on the airplane and the spiel, not that I've been on an airplane anytime recently, but, you know, it's kind of ingrained in our brains, right? That when you get on an airplane, you got to put the oxygen on yourself before you put on others. And if you're a caring person that's thinking about the kid next to you or a family member, that can feel kind of strange, but it makes sense. You can't help them if you're not able to be there for yourself. And, you know, I would say, yeah, this is hard. If you're a giving, caring person that's used to just putting others before yourself, it can be really hard to do that. But it's important to do that. And that's why we're talking about it today. And then just a gentle reminder that things might look really different now. We've been at home. We've been a little bit more limited in our movement. Self-care may look, self-care for me looks like an audiobook and, an audiobook at the end of the day versus before what activities I might be doing. So that's okay. Be kind to yourself. That's one thing to take away from this talk tonight, is to be kind to yourself. Why is this so important? This is so important because our bodies are like volcanoes. So if we are letting things build and build and build and putting others before ourselves or not listening to the signs and symptoms within ourselves, ignoring those times when you might be tired or feeling off or just, you know, kind of pushing it away, not practicing that self-compassion, then it builds and then it can become a crisis. And that could look like, you know, a health crisis, a physical health crisis. It could look like an overwhelming sense of anxiety or depression. It can look like, you know, whatever it looks like for anyone personally, but I think we all know that within ourselves. What does it look like when we haven't listen to ourselves and practice that self-compassion and it's built up? You know, we all have, I'm sure, memories to pull on of times when you can think about, okay, my volcano erupted and I can look back and say, I ignored X, Y, and Z. So we want to make sure that we're letting our steam out every day or as often as possible. I think I shared this last time too. Because I love these reminders. Part of self-compassion is recognizing what you can and can't own and not taking things onto your plate that are not yours to own. And you know, I know things are shifting with our COVID circumstances, and it sounds like in a lot of positive ways. You know, but there still is fear and anxiety out there, of course, because it doesn't just go away overnight. So, you know, sometimes it's helpful to take it out of your brain and map it out, you know? So if you're like, gosh, I have all these things that are on my mind, I will literally say, like, take it out of your brain, put it on paper, draw a circle. This is what I can own. This is where it makes sense to put my energy. Things outside of the circle are X, Y, Z. It's okay if I let those things go because my energy is not going to be best utilized by putting focus on those things. And so I think sometimes this is just a helpful strategy for when the world feels overwhelming, is really dialing it down to say, I'm being compassionate to myself by understanding what is mine to own and what is mine to let go. And you'll probably find there's a lot that can be outside of that circle of ownership. Personally, I just took Facebook off my phone because I was like, you know what? I don't really need all that information that I'm getting from there. And it's actually helped because I felt like I was getting a lot that I was viscerally being reactive to. So, and I was joking about this last time, but apparently toilet paper were fine. Ketchup packets are now the issue. So if you have ketchup packets at home, apparently there's a shortage. And hopefully gas is getting up and running again, because I know there were some challenges with that too. So just another helpful reminder too, right? So things are what they are until we put meaning to it. So I love this idea of like, it's raining. Yeah, it can be raining and it's no big, I mean, you know, it's raining. I don't love rain, but if I just say it's raining, okay, I'm going to deal with it. My perspective on my day is going to be different than if I say it's raining, I hate the rain, yada, yada, I wish I wasn't raining, on and on and on. The same goes into any day, or I would say maybe sometimes for clinic appointments or, you know, things that in our minds built. I use this analogy a lot that, again, I live in Maine, snow and cold, that our worries can become can start as snowflakes and build. And then before you know it, it's a snowball. And then it's like a snow person. And then it's, you know, a hill, and then it's an avalanche. And so where are the moments that we can let the snowflake drop and melt so that we aren't letting it build and it's not an avalanche coming over us? So if we can say it's raining, or it's a clinic visit, or it's a tough meeting that I was worried about, but it is what it is. We can let it drop and melt away. It doesn't take on more meaning. And I think that can be really helpful. Okay, so tips for decompressing. This is some stuff I didn't really get to last time, so I want to just kind of talk about some strategies that I have. And again, if you have questions or whatnot, I'm happy to. I can't really see the chat box, so I don't know if there's questions coming through the chat box, but Brian, if you need to jump in, just jump in, okay? Again, be kind to yourself. What's the best thing you can do for self-compassion is be kind to yourself. You know, 100%. And that is the best thing that you can do for yourself, is to just be kind to yourself and radically accept that you don't have to do the absolute most for self-compassion. Some things that you can do that are kind of compassionate towards oneself slash kind of stress busters is what I like to call purposeful distractions. So these are things that you can do that might take your mind off of something, or just if you find that something's stuck, it can take your mind off of it. So one thing is to engage your senses. And so everybody's kind of got different things that resonate with them. I love music. I love a massage. I like getting flowers for my kitchen table. Not so much a scent person, but other people might be. So it's kind of what are the senses that you're most likely to engage with, and what kind of positive reaction do those bring forth to you is kind of the thing that can, you know, you can take a walk outside and have how many senses can I engage? And that's a nice way just to do a purposeful distraction off of something that might be stuck there and bothering you. Engaging in activities that require focus. Again, you're getting your mind off of something. We don't want to push aside things and let them build, but sometimes we don't want to focus so much on something that's all consuming. And so puzzles, crossword puzzles, Sudoku, everybody's doing puzzles this year, it seems. And then something that creates competing emotions. So if you feel like kind of down, maybe watching something funny, maybe if you're feeling angry, you don't want a competing emotion and you want some rageful music, that's okay. Like just finding something that creates kind of that, it kind of resonates with you. So I always believe in uplifting content out there in the world. So these are my faves out there. I actually realize now I'm reading this, it's actually Fred and Fajoli, not Fajoli and Fred, if you're looking for them on Instagram, but it's really cute. It's two cats living on a boat in Greece and they're funny. And so I was going around to all of the staff in my office today telling them to follow them. Cause it's just silly and fun. I highly recommend. Fred is very naughty and his antics make me smile. So these are some, Tiptoe is a 175-pound tortoise. Useless Farm is hilarious. They're in Canada. All the animals have, they have emus and a bird named Brad, who's a total jerk. Like it's really funny anyway. So if you're looking for a good laugh and you're having a day, I highly suggest this.
Can I just jump in real quick, Meg? I love that distraction activities. And one of the things I've found helpful too is I kind of play a game with myself, like what's the smallest thing I can focus on? And especially being outside now, it's like the ants Like, what are the ants carrying and where are they going? Or like the grain of sand, or like the like how many petals there are on a dandelion. Like, but I think so much of the anxiety and stress in my life comes from too much, like the big picture and society and the globe and the environment and politics and blah blah blah. So like that like macro stress, I try to counter that with micro focus. And I love the example of a puzzle too, like especially the smaller the pieces the better.
I love that, and that's a great example too of just mindfulness. And mindfulness is something that's talked about over and over and over again, you know, because, well, first of all, right, part of the challenge is that we all have these phones, like, so, or whatever, right, most of us do. And so being able to go for a walk outside where you're not bringing your phone and listening to something, you know, being able to go and just be as present in the moment as possible and notice those things, like you were saying, can really make a difference. And it's a simple-ish thing, but, you know, mindfully eating, right? Putting the phone down while you're having lunch, seeing like, okay, what kind of things can I taste? What am I smelling? And just taking some time to tap into those senses can really ground us in a way that I think we all get really disconnected from when we have our phones all the time. So that was a great example. Yeah, thank you.
I think it, it worked for me, but if you go on a trip, drop your phone in the water like the first day. The whole rest of this trip is amazing.
I was gonna say that might cause some people more stress. So
it did at first, but in the long run, it was like, this is kind of nice to like forcefully unplug.
Yeah, the forceful unplugging. My mom has, last year I was feeling pretty, I was feeling kind of like you, Brian, with the world and everything. My mom, I grew up about 4 hours northeast of Portland, so way north near Canada. And my mom has this very rustic little camp on a very quiet lake. And I was so excited to go where there's no Wi-Fi, where it was just like, no TV, nothing. Like, you get up, you hear the loons, like you go for like a kayak, you just, it's quiet. And I, yeah, I didn't have to throw my phone in the water for that.
I'm not so disciplined.
It was a little challenging, but I was kind of forced into it, but it was really helpful for my kind of stress at the time, for sure. And then speaking of stress, this is one of my favorite, like, if you find yourself really worried, right, you've distracted purposefully, like, you're like, okay, I've done all the things, but something's really bugging me. Again, I love the idea of putting something from your brain to paper. Write down, what's the worry? What is the thing that's really bothering you, or the feeling or the thought that's really bugging you? Collect evidence. What about this do I know to be true? What do I know about this to be false? What's the likelihood of this happening? If this did happen, what's the worst thing that would happen? It's almost like a science experiment for your brain and your emotions. And then you can go back and challenge that worry that you had or that thought with this evidence. And over time, it can really help poke some holes in those things. So this has been a staple of my practice with my patients for a really long time. And it's 3 C's, catch, collect, challenge. I found it years ago, and probably not crediting someone out there with it, but it's just a great way to remember that we often in our minds, again, that snowflake becomes an avalanche because it builds. But if we catch that snowflake and let it melt, we can often get ahead of it. So that's one of my favorite stress busters. And a couple of helpful apps for some decompression and self-care. Talking about the mindfulness and meditation side of things, My Life is fantastic. They have 3, 5, 7, 1 minute meditations, mindfulness activities. It's low cost / free. Breathe is free. So if you're like, gosh, I've noticed that I'm really not be mindful. Like, we're all breathing. And I know people with CF are more in tune with breathing than anyone. You know, it's something that you know, gets measured, right? When you go to your clinic appointments, or if you have your home spirometer. But really taking that, like, concentrated, mindful, belly breathing breath that is also about calming the body and the mind. And I think it's Breathe that has this really cool lungs that expand and contract. Like, it shows you kind of breathing. If you love yoga, Find What Feels Good is great. They're wonderful. Again, free or low cost. And then Paint by Numbers, which the manager at work, I got her hooked on this and she's still obsessed with it. So those are just my go-to apps that I think are always nice to put in the mix of just, hey, I need something quick during the day. I do just want to talk about social media, right? Because I guess shared some helpful pages that are uplifting. But social media can also be a place that can be really dark and depressing and not uplifting. So making sure that, you know, if you're feeling in a funk, if you're like, my self-compassion is not there, take a stock of what you're looking at. Are you looking at things that uplift you? Are you looking at things that you feel, you know, gosh, like, I'm comparing myself to this person, and I don't feel good when I'm looking at this page or this content? You know, is it adding value or is it making you feel not as great? And so just taking stock of that, because again, we spend so much time on our phones. You know, it's okay to unfollow, right? Those million Instagram influencers will be fine without your one follow, is what I like to say. So that's why I try to, like, follow the uplifting content, because when I'm at work on lunch break and I'm just like, okay, I have a few minutes, what do I want to look at? I want to look at Fred and Fajoli because they're cute cats in Greece and they make me laugh. And I don't want to look at like the Kardashians. Again, sorry if the Kardashians are listening, but you don't uplift me. And maybe they uplift other people, but not me. So just a word on that. And I think just let's take a moment. I want to just share with you a great exercise, because I think this is kind of, yes, this piece. And then we'll talk a little bit, like we did last time, about just setting some positive self-care, self-compassion goals for yourself. So belly breathing is something I teach my kids, as I like to say, all my kids I see in my office, because it is a great way to just calm oneself down. So we're just going to take a moment to do that. And it is what it says it is. So this is a great opportunity to practice some mindfulness and just to try to be fully present in this moment. So one thing that I always suggest is just putting one hand that's kind of upper, you know, lung, chest area, and then you put the other hand on your belly. This is the time in your day that you can just let the belly hang. Don't worry about the nylons, the skinny jeans, the sucking it all in, like society always likes to tell us. And just think about that Buddha belly, right? Buddha has the belly that's round and full and just out there. So we, and I always love when I get to do this on Zoom because I realize how much I raise my shoulders. So if you can just take a moment too to think about what it's like to have what we call smiling clavicles. And so we want to keep ourselves open and think about maybe lifting up. You can lift up your shoulders and then just kind of drop it down. And you can close your eyes if you want or keep your gaze downward. But what we're just going to start to think about is how much that hand on our belly is moving. Just taking stock for yourself, just taking an inventory. Is that hand moving freely? is my hand that's up higher moving more? And then just seeing what happens when we do think a little bit more about the hand on the belly. So again, thinking just a little bit more about what it's like to breathe more into our belly. And one way that we can do this is to really think about slowing down our breath. So we can think about a breath in for three and a breath out for three. And I like to think of it like with our inhale, our bellies are inflating like a balloon, and then we exhale, the air gets pushed out. So your balloon doesn't have to be a big balloon. It doesn't have to be this giant balloon. We want to be focused, but not forced. And so the idea is just to think about how we can slow down our breath and really relax more of our whole torso and body versus being more focused in that upper part of our body. And then one thing that you can think about is breathing in calm and breathing out any tension that may be in your body or mind. It's just a little mantra that I sometimes suggest. So you're breathing and calming, relaxing energy. And you're breathing out any tension that's in your body or mind. You know, if you want, you can move your hand down to your belly, so both hands are on your belly, and just continue to take a couple cycles like that on your own. And it's really important to notice if there are thoughts that are coming into your mind, whether it's about the day you've had or the day ahead. You can say hi to them and then just breathe them away. You don't have to invite them in. You can acknowledge them and let them go. So just taking a couple more cycles of that nice long breath on your own. And then just maybe one more. And then if you're so interested, you can take an inhale and let out your last exhale. So we like to say like a lion's breath. You just let it kind of all go. So you breathe in and you let it all go. And then you open your eyes, kind of shake it out. And that's self-compassion. That's giving yourself a few minutes to say, I'm going to be present in the moment and breathe and calm. And I always feel a little bit more calm after I do that. So it's also great to do when you're laying down. And if you lay down with your knees bent and your feet like around bedtime on your feet on the bed or sofa or whatever, you can really kind of tap into it more. So it's just a nice way to relax. And if you can't tell, I love yoga. So legs up the wall. It's like a great way to calm down at the end of the day. So that's in this upper corner here. It's a well-known thing that can help you sleep and relax. So I know that there's been a number of classes through STROLO, I think, STROLO, that's been yoga. And I think there still is out there floating around the yoga. There's a yoga, right, for people with CF. I know we've had the DVD. I know that's floating around. But I personally think yoga is a great way to practice self-compassion and get some just good stretching in as well. So,
I think that's Yogi CF.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Or CF Yogi. I forget.
Do they still put out DVDs and stuff? Or is it, was it the, I think we have copies of the DVD. Does any, I still have a DVD player. I don't know if anybody else does, but kind of old school like that. Yeah, right. I know, on the computer. You know, I'm kind of old school. I can't part with it. I have all my 80s and 90s movies that I love. So, so one last thing I'll just say, kind of coming from today, is just to take a moment for yourself. We did this last time, but I think it's always important to revisit. And then we have plenty of time for more discussion too, but it's just to think about what is meaningful for you, right? In terms of self-care and self-compassion. And you know, what are the things that are going well that you know you're incorporating and you feel like, okay, this is really helpful. And then, you know, what are the things that you're realizing, okay, you know, this is something that it could be as simple as being kind to yourself. And I know that's not even simple, but you know, things that you would love to incorporate more. And and then we just set the goal, right? We think about what are the benefits that we gain from this. Is there anybody that needs to help me with this? Super cute story side note. I haven't worn my Fitbit in like a year. Kind of got away from it. And I have a patient I work with, who worked with for years. And he is not part of our CF clinic. It's a patient I've had from other specialty groups. And he loves his Fitbit, loves it. And so he's been telling me for a while. He's like, you got to get your Fitbit back on. You got to get your Fitbit back on. So I did. And now he emails me every day and he checks in and he's like, how many steps have you gotten? And it's really sweet. And I'm like, yeah, I got this many steps today. And so anyway, it's been kind of a nice thing. So he's keeping me accountable with my Fitbit. And then, you know, we all have obstacles, right, to meet our goals. I just needed to, you know, quite honestly, charge my Fitbit. It took me a year to do that. But now I've done it and I'm wearing it. And if there's any obstacles, what are those solutions? It could be trying to get to bed earlier, putting the phone down an hour before you try to go to bed, and anything else. And this is just really for you, right? To think about, how do I want to put myself first? How do I want to take the time for myself? How do I want to practice self-compassion? And put it on a sticky note, right? Put it out there for yourself so you remember that. When you go off to maybe do something else or rush here, rush there, just remembering, okay, I got to do this for me before I do anything for anyone else. So those are really important things to keep in mind is what's my goal for me? It's the thing I want to do for myself. And I think Brian pointed this out last time. It's really important to remember that, you know, this isn't about what anybody else might have for you, right? Like, you know, you got to do this, you got to do that. No, this is what's most important to you. It doesn't have to be do yoga every single day. It doesn't have to be, you know, run a marathon. It can be, remember to take a mindful walk or take a moment to breathe or, you know, those kind of things. So. And then I'm always happy for folks to reach out. So please do. I do a lot of these self-compassion talks for folks. And so I'm always happy to share resources. And then, yeah, just wanted to leave some time for discussion and questions and whatnot. So.
Thank you so much, Meg. That was really awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah. And since your last presentation, I have taken your advice and set a goal of trying to lay down in the middle of the day for at least 20 minutes.
Oh, I love it. Just to take some rest and take a break.
Yeah. I'm not very good at it.
It's okay. Sometimes I did a self-hypnosis class a couple years ago, and I love the saying, practice makes better, not perfect. And so you know, we so often get into that trap, right? Of like, oh, practice makes perfect. I got to be, you know, perfect at this. But any practice that you do makes you better at it. It doesn't have to be perfect. So I've always mm-hmm. loved that idea. So yay, that's amazing that you're doing that. As a reformed go-go-goer, I would still be a go-go-goer, I'm sure, to many people. Learning how to relax and not go-go-go is a challenge. So I commend you for that, because I know it's not easy, that's for sure.
Yeah. But the other thing that for years has been kind of my relaxation point in the day is just stretching.
And Yeah.
Just having like tight muscles, tight back.
Yeah,
tight
totally.
Intercostal muscles.
Yeah.
And, you know, just kind of connecting my breath with my movements.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Whether it's yoga or not, like just that mindfulness kind of can take me out of the craziness of the day. Bring me into the present moment.
One of the things that I actually teach to some of my kids is, again, the idea of, so in the self-hypnosis world, there's this, you know, mindset that you're, you know, that you're the boss of your body and your brain. So one of the things I teach them that is often really effective is to think about sending your breath to the areas of your body that are experiencing tension or tightness. And so being able to kind of do a body scan, progressive muscle relaxation, those kind of things. Because you're right, it doesn't always have to be some active major stretching. It can be a more still movement where you're just connected to, because if you're breathing more fully, if you're breathing in a way that's not as constricted, if you're able to just expand a little bit more, I think, or just focus a little bit more, can certainly make a difference in kind of your mind and your body. So again, I know people CF, like breathing is, you know, something that's a center point of your life, and something that you all are very acutely aware of. And I've actually taught some of the diaphragm belly breathing to some of our kids to help with some PFT, you know, anxiety, and just to feel like they can get their PFTs to more accurately reflect where they're at. So.
Yeah. That really is valuable. And I know for the pet lovers out there too, like even just those moments of like snuggling with your pet and mm-hmm. just like being present in that moment mm-hmm. is so valuable. And an exercise breathing that I've done to like kind of bring my breath down or just bring awareness to my breath is trying to match my breathing to their breathing. And it's not easy because their lungs are so much smaller.
Yeah.
But it's a good fun little activity.
Yeah, you can also like for yourselves too, like try to just tap with your heart. Like if you're like, oh, my heart's racing, like you can actually kind of like tap to your heartbeat, and it actually can help you realize like, oh, wait, maybe it's not going as fast as I think, or it's just another way to kind of tap into that. So
yeah.
Hopefully everybody's dogs are dealing with us all maybe moving out in the world a little bit more. So
dog is very annoyed with me with that. He's not a fan. I enjoyed me being a homebody.
I have continued to kind of say like I'm beginning to think that I'm gonna have to like start doing some pet therapy, because I think everybody's pets are gonna have some separation anxiety. So Giorgio, I'm reading your question. I don't think that I've actually met anybody in our clinics at the very least who have those two diagnoses. So
I had mentioned, Giorgio, that my older brother has mild cerebral palsy and also has CF. Mm-hmm. But I've met people with multiple sclerosis than CF.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
And I think cancer, as prevalent as it is in society, there's a certain likeliness of CF people having a prevalence, but.
Yeah, for sure. Unfortunately.
Yeah.
I mean, I think when I was working more with our adult clinic, chronic pain was something that people were certainly talking about a lot, and, you know, feeling, you know, young people, right, in their 20s, having chronic pain that they were struggling to try to find the best way to manage. I mean, I think there's, our bodies hold lots of things, and our bodies, like you were saying, Brian, it's not, you know, there are so many people that have CF that also have other challenging day-to-day struggles and things that they're facing as well, in addition to their CF. So, yeah.
And I think the, you know, the realization recently too of the mental health challenges that go along with any chronic illness. But the anxiety, the isolation, the depression is very real. And I think it's very common and probably more common than people realize because there's still the stigma of not wanting to talk about it. And I love hearing celebrities coming out and recognizing that it is a very real issue and there's nothing to be ashamed about, you know. There's so much weight on our shoulders in this world, CF being an extra weight and CP being an extra weight and any other diagnosis being an extra weight. But, you know, I think also it speaks loudly to how much our society hasn't for decades really practiced self-care. And you think about like in the 1940s and 50s, like, their self-care was smoking cigarettes.
you watch Mad Men, right? You watch an episode of Mad Men. Like they have a bar in their office. They smoke cigarettes. Yeah. They're going out to steak dinners and those kind of things. So I think I'm a big believer that stress gets stuck in our bodies and can make our bodies feel even more constricted and stuck. And, you know, I'm really glad that the CF Foundation has really put a focus on mental health, you know, for those of us that are social workers and whatnot. And I think this past year, it's interesting to see society all of a sudden in a lot of ways become more concerned about people's mental health from being in the, you know, one of the reasons I can't be on Facebook is because when you see people kind of outcrying about the mental health crisis that people are going through, and I'm so glad that people are saying that, but, you know, as somebody that's worked in the mental health field for a long time, you know, mental health is not a new thing. It's just evolved. It's certainly been exacerbated by the past year, but, you know, people have been struggling with their mental health needs for a long time. And so, you know, I think that the CF Foundation is usually kind of ahead of the curve with caring about, you know, the fact that the social worker has been part of the clinic for as long as it's been recommended. Is huge. So I can say as a social worker and a therapist right now, people are seeking help, which is great. And I find that a lot of teenagers are reaching out, which is always fantastic. And if you're a teenager or a parent of a teenager or even a younger child out there, connect them with our clinic social worker, and even if it's just to develop some of this coping strategies and skills to be able to continue to navigate the things that come at them, and to know that it's okay to talk about the things that are coming at them, it will make a huge difference in their lives going forward. Because as they grow older and navigate more and more of the challenges, whether it's, you know, academics or thinking about their future and independence and all of those things, I found that just being comfortable with talking through things and having some of those coping skills is really, really, it's amazing when I see the young people that I work with and their ability to navigate those things. It's really pretty incredible. Thank you, Brian. We have to talk about it. It affects our physical health. It's all intertwined. So we really need to talk about how we're doing from a mental health standpoint, for sure.
And I think the other thing that we've really, at least I've really missed the past year, is like the occasional just going to get a massage. Like massage envy.
Yeah.
No, I don't need a fancy spa, but just like the power of healing from the laying of hands. And I mean, there's so much religious background to the legitimacy of that. But during the quarantine, I, you know, bought so many other like massage devices and, you know, back, like vibrating back rollers. The punching or pounding massager, which, by the way, are like game changers.
I could walk over. We have a, like, it's not a Theragun. It's something we got from Amazon, but I could walk right over. It's like right over there. And it's great. Yeah. Just to kind of get in the back muscles. And
Well, when I was younger, I think even before the vest existed, I had, it looked like a wood jigsaw that like you would hold, and the thing would go up and down, and then it had like a cup at the end of it, and you would just like kind of pound yourself with this on the different areas. But it was like so relaxing too, and I'm like, where is that thing? I can't find it anywhere.
And not everybody's partners or family members want you to, you know, want to jump in, right? And it's not the same. Yeah, it's like, no, you're not going hard enough, like deeper. And then they just give up, right? So.
Yeah.
Totally. Well, hopefully we're all, you know, I'm, as you can tell, an optimistic, positive, I guess it's good that I'm speaking in our positivity series here. I'm a very much a glass half full person. And so I'm just continuing to try to remain really hopeful that we will have a much more healthy rest of our year, and whether that's emotionally healthy and it's nice weather where you are, or it's starting to feel comfortable being out of the house, or it's, you know, feeling good from an overall health standpoint and just in good health. I mean, I'm always hopeful that things will improve. So
absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, this has been great, Meg. Thank you so much again.
Yeah.
I didn't know, Rima or Tiff, if you guys had anything you wanted to chime into.
I think it's all been great. I like your volcano graphic. It's so true.
Yeah.
I feel like that sometimes.
Yeah, I just used that earlier today. With like a 7-year-old, and yeah, it's like, I think about it myself, like, am I letting my steam out? Are things building? And, it's something that's been like a staple of my, there's a great book. It's called There's a Volcano in My Tummy. If anybody has younger kids in their life, or if you're just curious, even as an adult, it's great. They have little exercises, but that's where I kind of took it from, is just, I love that idea that, you know, I think sometimes, and you know, again, people with CF are so in tune, right, with what's going on with their bodies. Sometimes our bodies will tell us before our brains tell us. And so even just tapping into that, like, okay, how do I know something's off? And a lot of the times it is, it's the body tensing or tightening, or you're just noticing a change, and that can be the cue. So, yeah, there's a volcano in my tummy. I use it all the time.
Thank you.
No judgment if you get it for yourself. Totally. I see you guys coloring volcanoes. It's totally fine.
That was my other thought when you were listing resources, was like, how much adult coloring books become popular, and just, again, kind of that, like, mindlessness of just coloring.
Well, and I always put too, the Paint by Numbers app. I shared this with staff because I'm always giving people resources, and the practice manager at my office, I was chatting with her today, and she said, I still use that app like all the time, and it keeps me distracted from checking Facebook and getting down this. She's like, I've now discovered this other paint by. So it's definitely one of those kind of mindless. I pretty much did about 10 of those on election night, because I was just like, okay, I need something else. They're just kind of fun and mindless. If you know, you don't feel like sitting and coloring, they have those on your phone. But yeah, I love adult coloring books. There's a CF one too, I think I've seen. I actually have in my office. I don't know who manufactured that, but it's
that's pretty cool. Yeah, I love coloring books, so I'm always my sister made all of us coloring books for Christmas.
Oh, that's amazing. That's a great idea.
Coloring those, very intricate, really cool.
I can't, my patience doesn't work for the ones that are super intricate, and I can't use colored pencils. It has to be markers. I can't see their shading, different colors, and I get hand cramps. I just can't do that for a very long time.
I love the mandalas that when I was painting by number on my phone, that was like my thing. And the paint by number on your phone is just like, it's, there's something soothing, because you press it and it just like will fill. It's just, there's something that's really like soothing about, so.
And easy.
Anyway. Yeah, it's kind of cheating, but in a you know. Well, I just appreciate, thank you, Brian and Tiffany, for having me back again this year, and happy CF Awareness Month. I think it's also Mental Health Awareness Month. So, we have our virtual walk this weekend up here, which is really exciting. So hope everybody stays safe and healthy. And like I said, reach out for real. Don't hesitate. I'm obviously, hopefully you can see, very accessible. And if you have questions or thoughts or just need some advice, I'm happy to help for sure.
That's great. And thank you. And thank you to the team at Maine Medical Center for sharing you with us.
I don't think they know what I'm doing half the time. Maybe I shouldn't say that on Facebook. I just kind of do my thing. I just do my thing. And then I'm like, oh, hey, yeah, like back in the fall or the spring, I did this. And so I don't think they know that I'm getting shared with the world, but that's okay. It's just how I roll.
All right. So. Well, we'll loop them in.
Keep it on the down low. No, just kidding.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I hope everyone has a good evening. It's still sunny outside here. So I'm going to go get a walk in, I think.
Awesome. I'm going to go start on dinner.
All right. Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Have a great night, everyone. Bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.